So I'm Judy Garber, and I'm director of the Cancer Genetics and Prevention Disease Center in Medical Oncology. And we're going to talk today about cancer genetics, the inherited predisposition kind, not cancer genetics so much the all tumors are abnormal kind, but we'll talk about both. So this is just to remind you, if you weren't familiar with how much genetics has become part of the mainstream. And this is an old slide because at least Life magazine no longer exists. Newsweek is about to go all electronic. Science is around and time is still there, but these have been emerging as issues people think about. And more, you know, we're now thinking about whole genome sequencing and having your entire genome characterized, whereas at this time, people were thinking mostly about finding genes for a particular disease. And that's still the goal, but the approach is different. So it's true that we think about cancer as a genetic disease. And when we say that, what we mean is that, and you've heard this before, I'm sure, that tumor cells are abnormal because their genomes have changed. And the genes, which are the instructions to the cell, the blueprints we talk about that tell the cells what to do, have been mutated or altered, and they start giving the cells abnormal signals. And these signals help cancer cells to acquire abilities that normal cells don't usually have. So cancer cells can divide all the time instead of dividing on command or not dividing. Most of our cells are sitting around most of the time doing other things. They're not dividing. But in cancer, cells divide on their own schedule, usually much more frequently than normal cells. Cancer cells can spread around the body and go to live in other organs. That's metastasis. So you'll see patients on many of the trials that some of you work on who have breast cancer, for some of us, in lung and liver and bone. Those cancers, the normal breast cells, can't take up residence someplace else in the body and survive. So it's the mutations in these cells that have given them these extra abilities. So in that sense, all cancer is genetic. But most cancer, 95% of it, is not occurring in people because of an inherited reason. And the other term for genetics, you know, most of us think about Mendel's peas or looking like your parents, that kind of genetics. Most cancers are not, at least predominantly, because of an inherited predisposition or a tendency. So just to get us all up to speed on the language, so this is basic biology, right? Genes are on chromosomes. Chromosomes are in the cell. They have genes arrayed on them, and the DNA is what makes up the genes. The way that cells give instructions from their DNA to the cell is that the DNA of the genes is translated into proteins, and the proteins are what tells the cells what to do. So around here, many people involved in clinical trials these days are looking at tumors for specific mutations so they can target their therapies, and that's what you want to do. You then want to look at the genome of the tumor, find the mutations, figure out which treatments might target cells who depend on those mutations, but the cell gets its translation through the protein. The incredible thing about DNA is its organization. So the double helix, you might have heard, it's the shape of DNA, and you've seen this. In fact, there's yet another new book about Watson and Crick who identified DNA. But the great thing is that it's made of only four bases or four DNA letters. And when we explain to patients about inheritance, we talk about this. And in every one, the right way is for every T to be matched with an A, A's and T's, and every C is matched with a G, every one. So you can see it should be that there are only the oranges with the pink and only the green is with the blue. And the genius of this is that when the DNA has to duplicate itself so the cell can divide and make new cells, it has a complete blueprint, because once the strands separate, you know exactly what has to match with them to make perfect replica DNA. And that's why it's so perfect. And it has to be perfect because all the instructions to the cells have to be exactly the same from the parent cell to the daughter cells. That's not my name. That's what they're called. But That way it's exact. And you can imagine that it's so important for cells to make their subsequent cells exactly the same that there are whole systems whose jobs are to make sure there are no mistakes and that this is a perfect replica the second time around. And when you think about the fact that your hair cells and your mouth cells and your blood cells are turning over all the time, this is happening in your body constantly, even just in the things that turn over quickly, let alone the ones that turn over more slowly. And the same systems are supposed to work in cancer, but you can imagine that since cancer is about mistakes in the DNA, common ways that cancer could happen would be for there to be problems in these systems of DNA repair that are supposed to fix mistakes when they're found, either detecting the mistakes or repairing the mistakes so that the cells are perfect the next time through. So this is a karyotype. A karyotype is a picture of the chromosomes of a cell. And obviously in this, not only are they obviously magnified, but they're also stretched out. And so they look like long lines. And this is what's called banding. So you can see that they don't look solid. They have this sort of pattern. And they're matched in pairs, since you get one each from each parent. So everybody has two pairs, except this is a male, so there's an X and a Y. I don't think I have a pointer, but you can see the X in the second row and the Y at the bottom. So women have two X's and no Y. So we have more genetic material. That's just the way it is. It's not necessarily defective that you have that little Y, but maybe. but this is normal, and this is what it should look like. And you, in your cell, of course, you could never fit all these if they were out. So, in fact, they're incredibly coiled, super coiled, to be able to fit all this genetic material in the nucleus. And the code is read as three-letter words. So this is a codon made of three base pairs, and the order is specific. It is part of the mechanism by which the cell tells its protein how to be made, because each three letters goes to a specific amino acid, and they're in a specific order, so that's exactly what that protein should be like. And we'll talk about the kinds of errors you can make. So mutations are just errors in the DNA or alterations in the DNA, and we use the word mutation to be one that's functionally significant. There's a lot of variation in DNA. We know that because none of us looks exactly the same, and that's because some of our genes are different, and some of our genes are probably exactly the same. The different ones are things that give you variation in hair color or eye color, height, affected by things like diet, but okay. But these are structural things. Functional changes are the ones that are more likely to affect cancer. So there's plenty of variation between two people, but there are also some things that are the same. So function is important in thinking about mutation. You've learned in high school or junior high school or these days probably fifth grade about dominance and inheritance. Cancer susceptibility most of the time is conferred by one gene, and it can be passed from parent to child. That would be dominant. We'll also talk about recessive inheritance. Do these words sound familiar? All that stuff you blocked out from biology. Recessive, when you need both copies of a gene, the one from each parent, to be abnormal so that the function of that gene and its protein is missing. Those are other traits, things like sickle cell, cystic fibrosis. Those are conditions where you're missing both copies of a single gene, so you need both parents to have a problem. Most cancer susceptibility is transmitted from one parent. And that leads to this. So the two-hit hypothesis, which is a little bit simplistic. It's the multi-hit hypothesis, but at least this was worked out mathematically by Albert Knudsen and Alfred Knudsen and Louise Strong, who are still living. And they studied retinoblastoma and Wilms tumor, so two childhood cancers. You might wonder often, why do kids get cancer? Because they haven't had time for exposures. They generally don't smoke, but even if they did, they're not alive long enough for anything to happen. So you think that most kids might have cancer because they had something that made it easier for that to develop. It's not necessarily true, but you certainly would think about childhood patterns. And what Knudsen and Strong recognized was that in families, for example, with retinoblastoma, a childhood tumor of the retina of the eye, that in the families where this occurred, often the tumors occurred in both eyes. And often they occurred in the children very young, in the first year of life, whereas when there was a child with retinoblastoma but no family history. They were at least a little older. Everything's relative, but they weren't quite so young. And they would occur as a single tumor in one eye. So they hypothesized that the kinds of genetic defects in tumors would be the same whether you had an inherited form of retinoblastoma or an acquired form of retinoblastoma, but that in the children with the inherited form, there was one hit, one problem already present. So in the retinoblastoma gene, in one of their retinoblastoma genes, in all of their cells, one cell, one copy was already mutated, and the second copy had to acquire its mutation for tumor to develop. Whereas in everybody else, you'd have to get both mistakes, both copies of the gene, and the chance that that would happen in the same cell. So you could hit one gene in one cell and one in another, but to happen in the same cell, in the same gene, that would be much less common. So retinoblastoma is an incredibly rare condition. But in some families, it's not. And so they call this the two-hit hypothesis because you'd have the first hit that you were born with, and the second one would be acquired. So this model turned out to be true for retinoblastoma, and that was the first gene that was cloned by Steve Friend, who used to work at the Farber. He cloned it at MIT, but he was part of the team. He'd been a pediatric fellow here in Bob Weinberg's lab in 1985. And the way we talk to patients about that is often this explanation, the sort of the brakes on the car hypothesis. So this is called a tumor suppressor gene because when it's present, cancer does not develop. And when you inactivate it, that's when cancer can develop. So it's like the brakes on a car. If you have two sets of brakes, you could lose one, but the other one is likely to help you stop. So you knock out the rear brakes, at least the front brakes are present. But if you're born without the rear brakes, then something only has to happen to the front brakes for cancer, for you to lose both sets, and now you hit the wall. So that's a tumor suppressor gene. And many of the genes that we think about today contributing to cancer, the colon cancer genes, the breast cancer genes, most of them are tumor suppressor genes. Now, there are also genes that are stuck in the on position. These would be called oncogenes. And here the idea would be that in all your cells, there's some gene that's like an accelerator. It's always on. And the question about this is, well, why don't you have cancer in all your cells all the time? Because often you don't need to do so much to the other copy, but sometimes you do. And Knudsen himself wasn't so sure this would be compatible with life. You'd think everybody would be born with cancer, but that's not true. There's still rare cancers, but this is one set of genes that can act this way. So back to our chromosomes, here are that same male karyotype looking so orderly, and on the right is a cancer karyotype from actually a BRCA1 deficient tumor. And they're laid out differently. They look like blobs instead of lines. But you can see that even in the bottom corner when you try to line them up, that there are some where there are two colors together and some where you're missing a piece and some where there are extra ones. And that's the kind of disorder that is typical of cancer cells once the regulation is off and weird things can happen. So cancer cells will often have, instead of 46 chromosomes like normal cells, they'll have 49 chromosomes, 55 chromosomes, 37 chromosomes, and within a tumor, they may not all have the same number either. And that's an example of how dysregulated things are in those cells. So lots of my examples will be from breast and ovary cancer because that's most of my patients, but there's some others in here. So if you were in the breast clinic and that young woman. So on a pedigree, the circles are women and the squares are men. Again, not my fault. That's just the way they are. Colored in means cancer in this case. So if I were in clinic and that 32-year-old woman came to see me with breast cancer, of course, I would wonder why would a 32-year-old have breast cancer? Breast cancer should be, although you wouldn't think it working around here, a disease of older women. But at 32, she has breast cancer. And she might have been worried about that because her mother had breast cancer. That's on the right side, that circle is her mother, who had breast cancer at 49. But her mother had two sisters who have not had cancer, and the grandmother's 80, and she didn't have cancer. So although my patient might have been worried about her mother, I wouldn't be so worried about that side. Breast cancer is pretty common, and certainly by 50, the chance of breast cancer in the U.S. is about 2%. But on the father's side here, where the square is, that family has a lot of breast cancer. And not only do they have a lot of breast cancer, but they have breast cancer at very young ages. So her aunt was 29 and her other aunt was 38. And the aunt who was 29 also had ovarian cancer. That line on there is because she's deceased. But there's been cancer, and you get the sense from that pedigree I showed you before that there's cancer in three generations. So from mother, from grandmother to mother to daughter. And that family would make you worry that there might be some genetic factor that is in this family is not passing on cancer, but it's passing on an easier time of developing cancer, a higher risk of getting cancer. So this family has features that would make you think that that might be the case. Now, if you're that 28-year-old sister, you're worried, of course, are you next? And until the 1990s, we would just say, you know, this is the family history, you would have to be worried. Now there's genetic testing, so it doesn't mean you won't be worried, but at least you could find out, if you know the gene in the family, do you share it or not? If you remember, your parents have these genes, they have a 50-50 chance of passing on the normal gene or the abnormal gene to each child. And as the child, that's your chance of carrying this. But not everybody comes in with a pedigree like that. So that family history is pretty classic, and we would hope that any oncologist today or breast surgeon would look at that family history, and even though it came from the father's side, not the mother's side, you would still be concerned that this family might have an inherited form of sensitivity to cancer. In these families, it would be a lot harder to see. So on the left, you have that same 32-year-old, but now on her father's side, he's only got brothers, no sisters. And his father had prostate cancer, another incredibly common cancer around here. But it is possible that there is an altered gene in the family that's being passed from father to son to daughter, and you just didn't see cancer because men so rarely get breast cancer and they don't get ovarian cancer. And since that's what this gene predisposes to, you might just miss it. So family history is important, but it's not always perfect in trying to find these families. So we would have tested this young woman today because she's so young and because her father's side of the family is not very informative for looking at risk. On the right side, I think she's 32 and has a brother, but her mother's 55 and didn't have cancer, but her aunt had ovarian cancer at 59. So the children of the aunt might have been worried that they could get cancer because their mother had it. Presumably, our patient's mother's not so worried. Why does she have cancer at 34 and her mother hasn't had cancer? Well, they don't follow the rules. Sometimes people are skipped, or sometimes the mother might have had something that protected her. So in this case, she had a hysterectomy. She had her ovaries and her uterus removed at 40 for some totally different reason, but the fact that she didn't have her ovaries reduced her risk of breast cancer and ovarian cancer, so there was no real reason that her daughter would know. And the grandmother there, we said she had colon cancer, but one of the problems we have in cancer genetics is that we have to rely on family history. And people, I mean, think about your own family history. The Surgeon General says you're supposed to talk to your family about family history. I don't think anybody does this. Why ruin a perfectly good dinner? But, you know, if you think about your own family, you may realize that you don't know that much about what your grandparents died from or what they had or what your aunts, uncles, and cousins might have had. And most people talk about stomach cancer. Anything in the abdomen will be called stomach cancer. When you ask your family, they're not going to, you know, they don't pull out their PATH report and tell you what it was specifically. And statistically, in the U.S., any abdominal cancer should probably be colon before anything else. It's the most common. But you do wonder in a family like this whether that was really ovary in the grandmother, and was this a BRCA1 or 2 mutation that even goes back that far. So this family is a real family, but I don't know what the grandmother had. It's a long time ago, and the family knows what they know. So I don't want you to go and look at your family and say, oh my God, there must be something hiding here that I'm not seeing, because that's not the case. But once there's reason to wonder, you have to look at your family a little bit differently and ask, well, could I have missed something? So remember, cancer is incredibly common. We tell everybody, right, that the risk of getting cancer over a lifetime is 1 in 2 for men and 1 in 3 for women. So most people have cancer. Most people have family history of cancer. Some just have heart disease, but most have some cancer. So a family history of cancer is the rule, not the exception. But when families have cancers that occur at unusually young ages, families have the same cancer occurring in multiple people. Everybody seems to have colon cancer. Everybody has breast cancer. My family history is all breast cancer. Then you wonder, is there something going on here? And of course, it doesn't have to be genetic. It could be environment, or it could be occupational exposure in families where everybody worked in the shipbuilding industry and they all got mesothelioma. But often it's the same. And remember, behaviors also cluster in families. So smokers, for example, often have family members who are smokers. Now, it should be that people who quit also have family members who quit, but because it's a lot harder to stop successfully if people around you are smoking. But so not all families will be the same. So if you're thinking about this from the genetic side, you would say, well, there might be something, not a strong gene like BRCA1 or 2, but a gene that does predispose. For example, you know, smoking causes heart disease, lung cancer, stomach cancer, esophagus cancer, cervix cancer. If you see a family that has all lung cancer, you think there's probably something genetic that made them all metabolize those carcinogens and get lung cancer instead of the whole array. But, you know, that remains to be seen. So in this day and age, what do we do? Well, genetic testing, since I told you that it's in all the genes, the good thing is that you can evaluate people for risk of different cancers just with a blood test, because the same genes that are in breast tissue or colon tissue or lung tissue are also in blood. In fact, they're also in white cells in saliva, so some tests now can be done without a blood sample, and that gets to a whole other thing about whether people want to do their testing without their doctors, but let's not go there for now. Testing costs. So it's a blood test to look at your genes. In fact, they often are covered by health insurance. And that's important because who's going to pay several thousand dollars for a test out of pocket just to be curious? But they are covered by health insurance. And most important, that you are not penalized for looking. So the GINA law was developed several years ago after a long time. Now, Massachusetts has always had, it feels like, 20 years at least worth of genetic privacy legislation, which doesn't say just that you can keep this information secret from your insurance. What it says is that if you have testing, you can't be penalized in terms of health insurance. So this was before the days of Obamacare or RomneyCare, whatever you want to call it in Massachusetts, but that you cannot use a genetic condition to discriminate and not provide health insurance or charge more for health insurance because someone had risk of developing a condition that was could be expensive to take care of. So those are what the GINA laws are for. The problem is they don't cover things like disability insurance or life insurance. So we often do tell people who are interested in finding out about their genes that they might think about making sure they had good coverage before they were tested to make sure that they don't have a problem afterward applying for something that the law does not protect. Around here, we often test people when they have a cancer diagnosis because that's the first time for some people that they become aware that there's a problem in the family when they themselves are diagnosed, and because, of course, many people are worried that they might pass something on to their children or their relatives, and they want to know, is there something for the family to worry about or not? And autonomy and access is just the importance of making sure that people are being tested because they are ready to be tested, not because either their doctor or their relatives think it's a good idea. And the access issue is because insurance doesn't cover everything and genetic tests are expensive. One good thing is you only have to do many of them once because your genes don't change, but they still can cost at the time. So we said that genetic information is important for relatives. So this is not the genetic information in the tumor. So we test breast cancers for HER2, and we test, you know, colon cancers for RAS, and we test lung cancers for EGFR, and if you go to enough of these talks, all these letters will start to make sense. But this is talking about testing things you were born with, and that means that your family members could also have them. So you have to think about, when someone is tested, the implications of their information. So in this example, that young woman at 32 was positive. That's that little plus sign up there. She has a four-year-old who I would not be testing right now for a genetic factor, but she has a sister. And in this example where I took out all those people in the middle, There are other people who might be interested in her information. And one of the things we talk to people about is who might be interested in your information and how will you share it with them. So that's why we have genetic counselors who explain all this before people have their blood drawn to make sure that they've considered those issues before they start, or later, or many times. So I don't know if you remember Where's Waldo. So some of you might if you're older or have small children. So this is the Where's Waldo model of genetic testing, because the first time someone in the family is tested, you have to find Waldo among all those DNA letters that look exactly the same, but somewhere there he is, and once you find him, then you always know where he is. So in this example, Waldo is in the upper right-hand corner. He's the guy in the red striped shirt. But he looks a lot like the rest of them, and so the first time you look in a family member, it will cost full price. So for BRCA1 and 2 testing, it's about $4,000. For colon cancer testing, it can be up to $10,000. It depends on how long it takes to find the mutation. But once you know where it is, you only have to look again. So if I show you this slide again, you know exactly where Waldo is, so now it's like $500. In fact, it could cost a lot less, but that's what the labs charge. And it's definitive. If a family has a mutation, you either have it or you don't. If you don't have it, you don't have the risk. If you do share the mutation, then you do share the risk. So once you know where the mutation is in the family, then genetic information becomes definitive. Now, it's not perfect, because people without a BRCA1 mutation can still get breast cancer. It's a common disease. And other things can happen. You can still get run over by a truck outside the Farber, so you still have to be, you know, nobody gets immortality out of this. But at least you can have a sense of how much your risk is at different ages, in particular related to family members. Well, what do you do with genetic information? So this is just an example from breast cancer. So when we identify women who have increased risk of breast cancer because of these genes, we think about different things. We think about watching them more closely or more often or starting at younger ages to try to find their cancers at the earliest possible time. So remember, we said in the retinoblastoma example that those kids with the inherited form were younger than kids with the acquired form. And the same is true here. We said breast cancer is a disease of women in their 50s and older, but inherited breast cancers can occur in the 20s and 30s, depending on the gene. So we start monitoring with mammograms and breast MRIs in the 20s in women who know they have a mutation. So that's like 25 years of extra mammograms. Not much fun, but the idea of finding cancers early, and we can study these women and make sure that the testing is worthwhile, that you actually can find the breast cancers early this way. Otherwise, it's just a lot of looking without a lot of yield. That would be a problem. We have a problem. We have to find early ovarian cancer. And those of you who work in the GYN group know that there really is no good early detection for ovarian cancer. Ultrasounds and CA125 blood tests really don't work, and the preventative Health Services Task Force just announced that women without inherited risk should not be having ovarian screening, because it's worse than not working. It led to unnecessary surgery too often. So here we would like to have a way to look early, but we don't. Chemo prevention means having ways of reducing risk with medication. So in breast cancer, we have tamoxifen, which is a drug that's used to treat breast cancer that some people take actually to lower their risk of breast cancer. We don't know for sure how well it works in women with mutations, but we know in the general population that women who have increased risk can take tamoxifen, so it's an option here that we think about. We know that birth control pills, for example, in the general population and in women with mutations, lowers ovarian cancer risk. So that seems like a good thing, although we have to be a little bit careful about breast cancer risk. And then we know that surgical removal of the organs at risk can also prevent cancer. So those pictures all come from the internet, but it is an option. And of course, you would never want someone to go through disfiguring surgeries like mastectomies or surgeries that make you menopausal, like having your ovaries removed or having your colon removed or your stomach removed for other conditions without a really good reason. And some of what genetic testing was supposed to help do and has helped do is to identify women in the family who really are at risk and identify the ones who aren't, so they don't have to do something like this. Now, people do this surgery, and it seems like a huge deal, which it is, but you can imagine that if you've been in a family where all the women before you have died before their 50th birthday from cancer, you might not think it's so outrageous. Still, you know, we try to help people make good decisions about this, decide when in their lives they might do this or not. And I will say that at least reconstructive surgery has gotten much better. So when women have to think about something like this, it's possible. Now, there are plenty of organs that you can't remove. And that's like the pancreas, for example. Pancreatic cancer families are studied here, and it's pretty tough to take the pancreas. The problem with taking the ovaries is menopause, and it has its own problems, and no one really would like extra years of menopause, so this is an issue. But we do study, at least, and try to figure out whether, if you're going to make someone menopausal by taking out their ovaries, can you give them back estrogen so they feel better and do that safely. So some of what we do in the genetics program is try to identify people with risk and then figure out for them how can we help modify their risk and still have good life, because they're trying to get rid of the worry about cancer and the worry and the burden of that, and you don't want to replace that with new problems. But we're not perfect at this yet. So here for the colon cancer people is just to show that I've talked about breast cancer, but the same sort of inherited predisposition exists for most cancers. So in adult cancers, we estimate that about 5% of all cancers have an inherited, are the inherited group, and then 95% are not. So that says that, you know, from a public health point of view, you still have to get rid of smoking and obesity and inactivity and all the other carcinogens to make a real dent in cancer. But we're talking here about people who have an unusually high risk of the disease. So for colon cancer, the general population risk, the lifetime risk, is about 5%. Somebody who's had a colon cancer has a higher risk of getting another one someday. Whatever made the first one happen, the whole rest of the colon was exposed as well. There are inflammatory bowel disease. These are like Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis, if you've heard about those. Especially ulcerative colitis is associated with a higher risk of cancer down the road. And the thinking is it's mostly for people who have chronic inflammation, and the irritation is enough to cause error over time. HMPCC is a type of hereditary cancer predisposition, and FAP is another type. And you can see that they're associated with almost 100%, not 100%, but very high risks of cancer. These are the genetic forms. These are the ones that people want, in theory, to know whether they have risk for so that they can do something to prevent it. So they don't have to worry about birth control pills and prophylactic mastectomies, but they have colon cancer risk, and for HNPCC, they have risk of uterine cancer. So for them, surgery may still be an option. Surgery is not what we want to be doing 5 years from now, 10 years from now, certainly not 20 years from now. So part of what we all try to do is look into other ways to try to reduce risk. But it's obviously not enough at this moment for everyone to live with the risk, and that's why surgeries are options. So this is an example of a colon cancer family instead of a breast cancer family. So CO is colon on these, UT is uterus, ST is stomach. So this is a family where you can see that the grandfather had colon cancer at 45, too young for colon cancer. His sister had uterine cancer at 38. Uterine cancer is a disease of older women. Stomach cancer. So these are the same problems. Cancers too young, cancers in multiple generations, cancers that look like they go from parent to child as adults, of course, but where there's too much cancer. And in this family, when this young man had cecum as part of the colon at 35, his brother was able to be tested and see that he did not share the risk. His daughter is only 4. Someday, when she's old enough, you might think about testing her too. You also can't assume that all cancers in the family necessarily are related to the gene. In this family, you can. But if there were someone with colon cancer in the family at 82, you might think that's more likely to occur just because colon cancer is common, and you'd wonder, how did that person avoid cancer for 82 years? On the other hand, none of these genes gives 100% risk of cancer, and there are people who carry the genes and do not develop the disease. So the goal is for that to be everybody's future. So Li-Fraumeni syndrome is a syndrome that we studied here for a long time because Fred Lee was here. So I don't know that any of you remember Fred. Somebody does. Fred was here for a long time. And this is just to remind you that there are some really awful inherited syndromes, and some of them do include childhood cancers. So this is a breast cancer patient, that same 32-year-old, but now her sister had an adrenal cancer at 5 and a sarcoma at 14 and another one at 26. And this is one problem with these inherited risks. For some of these syndromes, people survive one cancer only to develop another one. So it is another sign that cancer, that a syndrome might be present in the family. And in the old days, we looked at these families and said, you know, this is terrible, but what can we do for them? So we can do genetic testing, we can figure out who has the risk, but once you have the risk, what do you do when you're not focused on a single site? So we have been thinking about that. So if you can't read it from the bottom, it says that I've been here sooner if it hadn't been for early detection. So we spend a lot of time screening around here. So we did a study at the Farber looking at FDG PET scans. So these are PET CT scans done in the nuclear medicine department. And in this study, we had 15 patients with Li-Fraumeni syndrome who had been well at either forever or at least for 5 years. And three of them had small cancers that were found by the test. Now, the problem is that the test is, I mean, it's expensive. That's not the main problem. The main problem is that there's a lot of radiation in this test. And you don't really want to use a test that's based on radiation every year for people who have a sensitivity to cancer. You're worried you'll cause more cancer than you save. But there's been another study. This one was from Toronto, but the same study is being done here now together between the pediatric group and the adult group. This was looking at Li-Fraumeni patients using whole body MRI. So MRI is not radiation, it's magnets. And the technique for this was worked out so that in an hour, or an hour and a half, depending on the size of the person, I think, you can look from basically head to at least the knees without contrast, so no injections, and you can look at for early signs of cancer. And in this study, they showed that people who elected to have the cancer screening actually did very well. They're the red line across the top. They were all living when they published this, but people who weren't having screening actually died more often. Now, that's not a technically perfect study, because one problem is the first time you study people, you're much more likely to find whatever was quietly growing and not announcing itself than if you have been looking on a regular basis. And there might be some bias in the kinds of cancers that you wouldn't find on screening. The ones that grow so quickly, they don't wait to be found on an MRI. But nonetheless, this was encouraging that there might be a technology to use. And so families with Li-Fraumeni now are participating in studies around the country. They're pretty rare, so you can't do this all in one place. But to evaluate this technology and see if this is actually a useful way to manage these families. And not just Li-Fraumeni, but there are other conditions too where you can't say there's just one place to look, just the colon where you can do colonoscopies, or just the breast where you have to look everywhere, and where a technique like this might be useful. So this is happening, and at least it gives us something to be thinking about as an option. We do think about cancer and our cancer patients. So this is in breast cancer. Does it matter if someone's breast cancer happened because of a mutation, or it happened the way most breast cancer happens when we don't know why? And it turns out that there are decisions that people might make differently if they knew that their risk was higher because of their genes. Not always, but for example, as we said, if all the cells in the body have a mutation, it's possible that the risk of having a second cancer would be higher. We showed that in the Li-Fraumeni family pretty dramatically, where they had so many multiple primary cancers. But certainly, patients with a BRCA mutation have more risk of a second breast cancer. They also have ovarian risk. The HMPCC patients have colon cancer risk and uterus and other. So not only do you want to think about curing the patient of the disease they have, but you want to think about the risk they'd have to go through this all over again. And some people would make different surgical decisions based on that, either removing more tissue at risk or thinking differently about their treatment. So not all the time, but increasingly we use this. And there's some data, too, that the tumors that occur in people with mutations are a little bit different. And this is something that's being studied more and more as the technology for looking is more and more available, and that might either influence treatment, or it might help you think about testing someone you would not have otherwise tested because they didn't have that much family history, but their tumor was a specific type. And there are data that people with mutations do better. not just worse. So I think we all have worried that people with inherited forms of cancer, because of these genetic issues too, where we use chemotherapy drugs around here that damage the DNA and cause their own problems, that our patients with inherited risk might actually do worse overall. And these are data from MD Anderson that might be hard to read, but what they basically were looking at in this study was a group of women who had chemotherapy as their first treatment for their breast cancer before surgery, and then they tried to predict who was going to do better. And what they showed in the top lines here was that people with mutations actually did better than people without. So you can hypothesize all kinds of reasons why their genes might have been helpful in this regard. Remember, they're fixing errors in the DNA, and tumors are full of errors in the DNA. These tumors can't fix their errors because they're missing their BRCA genes. So when you blast them with chemotherapy, maybe they just can't repair themselves and they die more easily. Great theory. But in any case, you can't assume that these are more lethal cancers just because they're inherited. So what do we do when we have a family that looks like this and we say, well, we expect that there should be a mutation? This is the same family I showed you before, although I think I took out the sister. But you certainly look to this family, think there must be something. But often we test these families and we don't find the mutation. And that's probably because there are a lot of genes that we haven't identified. So what are we doing about that? Well, now there are more genes. So we've been for years testing for BRCA1 and 2, but in breast cancer now there are these panels of genes where you can order a test that looks at 10 or 12 genes at a time. I think we're up to 29 in one of the panels. That's true for breast cancer. That's true for colon, ovary, and also there's a panel called Cancer Next, which is we're not sure what your syndrome is, but we can at least look at a lot of cancer genes and try to figure it out. And all of this is because soon we're just going to be testing all the genes. So this is the first report that I know of in the general medical literature of a woman who had breast cancer and then had ovarian cancer and then had a recurrence of her ovarian cancer and then had leukemia and didn't have any family history in her parents at all. And they looked at her for BRCA1 and 2 mutations, but they didn't find anything, even though it was breast and ovary. And they sequenced all her genes, and they found a P53 mutation, which is a gene for Li-Flamini syndrome, which she also, you know, she didn't have childhood cancer, you didn't know, but she did have that. So it was a pretty expensive way to look, although the costs are coming down. And you'll skip that. So people are wondering, how in the future are we going to do genetic testing? So this is a slide from Andrea Richardson, who says, you know, you're looking at the tumor. This is what tumor looks like under the microscope, but you're thinking about the genes. And if you've never seen this slide, this is from Levi Garrow, actually, I think it's from Bill. But the idea is then the era in which we already are, and certainly where we're going, we don't have to look one gene at a time. You know, it's always a good idea to know what you're looking for, but you don't have to do BRCA1 and 2 testing for $5,000. You're going to be able to do all the genes. And you'll be able to look at the tumors and look for genes altered in the tumors that you might target for therapy. But you'll also be able to look at the blood and ask, are there genes here that might explain where this tumor came from? Now, this is high technology, but there are already projects going on in the Institute that are doing this, that are looking at lung cancer and colon cancer in one of them. Prostate cancer just was funded for a project like this. Breast cancers, there are a lot of these. The testing turns out to be mostly done by robots, and long sequences of DNA can be read. You have to interpret them. And people wonder, and you've heard this, I'm sure, by now, that are the tumors going to be more alike if they have the same mutation, even if they developed in different places? So if you have an EGFR mutation in lung cancer and in colon cancer, will those tumors behave more like each other or be treated more like each other because their molecular findings are more similar than where they arose in the body? That's probably going to be a little trickier. And many other things determine the behavior of tumors by where they grew up and all the other influences about them, their epigenetics and their environments. So I'm not sure that this will all turn out to be, but some of it will. And on the germline side, you'll be able to ask things about susceptibility. But you have to worry a little bit, too, about other things that you'll find. So What do you find in the tumor? You find potential targets. That is the goal, to find things that you can treat in these tumors that might allow you to successfully eliminate them without damaging normal tissue that doesn't have these mutations. For your own genome, when you have your blood looked at, you could try to find variations in drugs that affect the metabolism of treatment. So why is it that the same people getting the same drugs, one person has terrible toxicity, the other person doesn't? Some of that is genetic, not all. You could find things about risk of cancer that would be important to the patient's families. That's what we've been talking about mostly. But you also may find other genes. After all, you're not just looking at the cancer genes, you're looking at all the genes. And you could find things that people may be less interested in knowing about or more interested in knowing about, depending. There are a lot of different kinds of genes. So this is my favorite New Yorker cartoon, which says, as if we didn't already know too much about ourselves, we're having our DNA done. So you can have your DNA done. For $300, 23andMe will sequence your DNA from your saliva and tell you something about your genes. They are going to be looking at specific genes, not all of them yet. But in this, there's a typo in this cartoon, under that before having, there's a V. So most of us just corrected that right out, didn't really notice that it was there. And besides, I love that the New Yorker had a mistake. But besides that, I mean, how big a mistake was that? That little thing that didn't really change it very much, or did it? One of the challenges of reading the genetic code in all these genomes we're going to be looking at is knowing whether those subtle changes are important or not important. And this kind of variation is going to be a big problem when we look at 30,000 genes and we know what the normal sequence is, but we see all these variants. It's going to take a long time to sort them out. And the uncertainty about that is something that people have to recognize before they sign up to have their genes done. So there's a lot of risk and benefit in all of this. I think there's a lot of benefit, so I'm glad the benefit side is a little wider on the slide. But I think the goal is to use genetic information for good. And I think that over the years, despite our fears that a lot of genetics would not be used for good, much of it has. I mean, most genetics, remember, started as prenatal genetics. Most people wanted to know about their kids. Now they want to know more about their own conditions, sometimes to understand why something happened, sometimes particularly to know about passing it on. This is true for cancer and not cancer. But it is also true for cancer that we have families here who are perfectly healthy and the goal is to keep them that way, but to recognize that they might have more risk. Some families we can't do much about it, but some we can. But we're about to enter an era where we're going to find out a lot of information all at the same time. And we'll have to sort out which parts are useful and which parts will it take us more time to figure that out for. We've been doing cancer genetics. Well, my son is going to be 22 next week, and he was born the day BRCA1 was mapped. So 22 years, I'll say that. Hard to believe. I thought I'd come back to work. It was all going to be done, but not yet. But we still have more to do. So risks and benefits, we'll figure it out. And thank you for coming, and thanks for your attention. And I have a few minutes for questions. So the question was, I'm sorry, what about people who are adopted and don't know about their family history? So certainly our patients who develop cancer at young ages and don't know anything about family history, we test them if they want to know. And we sometimes test people who have been contacted by their birth families or the agencies and found out that there's something in the family history and want to know. Remember that most people don't have genes that predispose to cancer, so we don't test them. But in the days when everybody's having their genomes done, then there'll be a chance to know a little more. The question was, what does the insurance industry think about preventive surgeries? So actually, they cover them most of the time. And I think they do so because, for two reasons. You know, their insurance industry is all about probability. And they figure out, you know, what's the chance they'll avoid treating cancer, which is a lot more expensive than surgery. One of the reasons they're not all thrilled about this is that in the U.S., most people change insurance pretty often. So even though you get it through work, the average time of stay with a health insurance company is 2 years. So they think, you know, should be somebody else's problem down the road, but nonetheless, they do pay. And I think the other thing, especially in cancer, is the bad publicity that would result from someone getting a cancer and saying, I got this because my insurance company wouldn't cover me.
that probably. Do you have to like build a case to justify?
For people, so because I think the law has made it that they can't discriminate based on knowing your genetic status, you don't have to lie. You can say, I have had this test, I have a BRCA mutation, and I want to have surgery, and most of them will cover. If you have a family history and there has not been testing or you haven't found something, it sometimes can be trickier. You know, we're trying not to do surgery when it doesn't need to be done, but I would say that most of the time there is a way. There are some insurance plans, as you all know, that are so restrictive that it doesn't help much, but most of the time you can get things covered, especially for conditions like this.
Okay.